Greetings, my fellow Fright Fiends. It's your buddy Boogeyman Ben here for a new episode of Boogeyman Ben's Horror Zone, and this is part 9 of my countdown to Halloween series. My apologies for this not coming out last week as it should have on schedule, but as I've mentioned in a previous video, I did have a vacation that came up, and I just didn't get enough time to record this video. So this week you will be getting two. You will be getting part 9, which I'm doing right now, and then the final one will be coming out tomorrow, which will be Halloween. So without further ado, I'd like to get to the countdown. But first, I wanted to do a couple of honorable mentions, and I think one of them would have been in the countdown, but it was released only a couple of weeks ago, and that is the new Halloween film. And that definitely would have been a series. But because it came out after I had already started doing the countdown, I didn't think it was fair to fit it in here. It definitely would have been a part of this countdown had it come out before I started this series. The other one I want to mention, and the reason why it's not in this countdown, is because it's a fan film, and I specifically limited this series, this top 100, to theatrical releases. But this one is Never Hike Alone, and I just got it. This is the Blu-ray DVD combo pack that was part of their Kickstarter that they had. I'm gonna say it's back in April. I might be pushing it. It was early spring, I'm gonna say, but I, you know, donated the money to it, got it. It just arrived today, so it's perfect timing. But this is number 330 of 1750, so they only made 1750 of these. It's right there. And it's, like I said, it has special features on it and everything. So I absolutely love this film, and I consider it part of the Friday the 13th canon. I think Vincente DeSanti and his crew and cast did a fantastic job on this, really paying homage to the original Friday the 13th film series, and also giving us a very different Friday the 13th style film that I think is fantastic. And if you haven't seen it, it is on YouTube. You can watch it for free. I was lucky enough to get one of the physical copies of it, and I treasure it very much. Because it's a fan film and it's not a theatrical film, I didn't include it in my top 100. So, but still, an awesome film and one of my favorite Friday the 13th films. That being said, let's get to the countdown. We're going to start with number 20. That is going to go to Friday the 13th Part 2. I absolutely love this film. I think it is a fantastic follow-up to the original Friday the 13th, and I think it's a better film than the original Friday the 13th. I love Steve Dash, who played Jason in this film. I know Warrington Gillette gets top billing, but he only played him in a handful of scenes, specifically the one where he jumps through the window. But, you know, getting to meet Steve Dash this year was also a terrific thrill. What an awesome guy. It was an honor meeting him. He's fantastic as Sackhead Jason. I'm glad that Sackhead Jason is getting some more love right now. I think people are really starting to like that look for Jason because the hockey mask and that look is so iconic. Sackhead was only in one film. Two, if you count the reboot where he was briefly the Sackhead Jason, paying homage to this film, but Steve Dash will always be the OG for that. And I think he's terrific in this. Amy Steele is Jenny Fields. I think she's the best Friday the 13th final girl in the entire franchise. Terrific cast, terrific acting, really a scary movie. I think Steve Miner really took the reins from Sean Cunningham and made a better movie than the original. Now, number 19 on my list is a tie, and this is a tie between Jeepers Creepers 3 and Jeepers Creepers 2. People are probably going to be really shocked or pissed that this is as high up as I have it. I mean, not only is this in my top 100, but it's in my top 20. I know the issues with this film. I know about the director's past. I know that a lot of people feel that this film has too many shortcomings to be considered a good film. I love them because I love Jonathan Breck as the Creeper. I think he did a fantastic job in this film, and despite the limitations of the budget on this film, I actually really enjoy it, and I've said my piece about it. I've already done a review of it. Same thing with Jeepers Creepers 2. I have some issues with this, particularly some of the kids that are on the bus. I find them irritating. I think the cast is a little bit stronger in Jeepers Creepers 3 than Jeepers Creepers 2, but I enjoy both films equally. I probably would put 3 over 2. I still have that same feeling as I did when I first watched it. Jonathan Breck steps into the Creeper role after a 14-year hiatus seamlessly. He's fantastic. I hope they make a part four. I love both of these films in this one, specifically Ray Wise. I think he's fantastic as Taggart. I love the Captain Ahab to the Creepers Moby Dick that's going on through this film where he's chasing the Creeper down. I think that's the strength of Jeepers Creepers 2. I also love the effects. I love the way that Jonathan plays the Creeper in this as well. Just films that I really enjoy watching. I don't care if people hate them. I really love them. Number 18 on my list is going to go to Friday the 13th Part 3 in 3D. One of the very first Friday the 13th films I ever remember watching. Steve Miner did another great job directing this film. I also love the cast. Dana Kamel, Paul Kraka, Larry Zerner, Tracy Savage. Fantastic cast. Can't say enough great things about it. Love the 3D shots. I know they're cheesy to some people, but I absolutely love them. They're a lot of fun. This film has always been one of my favorites, and it continues to impress me even to this day. Absolutely love this film, and rest in peace to the late, great Richard Brooker. Number 17 is going to be another tie, and that is a tie between Psycho 4 The Beginning and Psycho 3. I love both of these films equally. I do think 4 is a little bit better than 3, but 3 was directed by the late great Anthony Perkins, my favorite actor of all time. Both films are very important to me. They further established my appreciation and my affection for the Psycho franchise, as well as the character of Norman Bates. It made me a huge fan of Anthony Perkins, even more so than I had after seeing Psycho 2. I like 3 for the fact that it really has a slasher movie vibe, which was really popular back in 1986. It really pushes the gore and the black comedy, something that really was a tribute to Hitchcock and homage to his style of filmmaking. I love part 4 for it's showing, giving us a backstory to Norman Bates, showing what his mother was like when he was a young boy and how he became cross-dressing psychopath that we met in the original Psycho. Both films are fantastic, directed by Anthony Perkins and directed by Mick Garris, which I still think is Mick Garris's best film. Absolutely love these films, and they both tie for me. Number 15 is going to go to the Friday the 13th reboot, one of my favorite remakes of all time. I love this film, absolutely adore it. I had the honor of meeting Derek Mears about 8 years ago. What an awesome guy. I hope that one day we will get to see him reprise his role as Jason. This film is fantastic for me because, again, it didn't tried to remake any of the films. What it did was it took elements from the first three Friday the 13th films and made one new story. And it also took elements from part 7 with like the sleeping bag murder. Love the opening of it. The opening is kick-ass. And Jason is a beast in this. Derek Mears played him with such ferocity. But he did such a great job in this film, and so did the entire cast. I love Jared Padalecki, Daniel Pannebaker, Aaron Yu, Travis Van Winkle. Everybody in this cast did a great job of playing their part. And there's plenty of drug use and nudity and sex and violence. I mean, it's everything a Friday the 13th fan would want, and I still don't get the criticism for this film. I think it's fantastic and easily one of the best remakes ever made. Number 14 on my list is going to go to Friday the 13th Part 7, The New Blood, a film that has really grown in popularity with me. When I was a kid and I first saw this film, I was 14 years old when this film first came out, and I remember I was very disappointed in the execution of it and the ending especially. There's still some reservations I have with it, but knowing what the director went through to make this film and knowing that his associate producer really just kind of fucked up his entire production and made him cut things, and the MPAA went after him and made him trim down all the violence and all the over-the-top kills in this, it really breaks my heart as a Friday the 13th fan that we didn't get to see all of the hard work that Jean-Carl Beekler put into this film. Also, Kane Hodder is Jason. He takes Jason to another level. I mean, he played him as this character that has been under Crystal Lake for years, comes out, you see all of the wear and tear that he had through all of the earlier films, everything that has happened to him, and he has such a presence as Jason. Fantastic performance. I love Lark Park Lincoln as Tina. She does a great job with the telekinetic scenes, and there's just some terrific action, especially the last part of this film where Tina and Jason go head to head. I mean, it is a fantastic throwdown, and Jason is just getting pummeled by this woman with the psychic powers. I just absolutely love it. It's a lot of fun. It's really grown on me, and I really appreciate it. I do wish that we would get an uncut version of it, but that being said, I still love watching it and still think it's one of the best Jason movies ever made. Okay, number 13 on my list is going to go to Stanley Kubrick's The Shining. This film terrified me before I even saw it. The first time I ever saw anything to do with this film, I was about 6. And I remember the first image I ever saw was Jack Nicholson. It's the scene in the movie after he's killed Dick Halloran. And that was the scene in the trailer, or in the commercials, that I remember seeing it. I would hide behind our couch every time that would come on. Scared the crap out of me. I was just terrified of looking at any image of Jack Nicholson. He just absolutely terrified me. I didn't really watch this film all the way through until I was about 20 years old. So it took me a long time to fully watch this film and embrace it. And what a masterpiece this film is. Now, I've read the Stephen King book and I've seen the miniseries, and I appreciate the miniseries and I love the book. But what Kubrick did with this film is just phenomenal. Yes, he turned it into more of a domestic tragedy than a haunted house or haunted hotel story. Whereas Jack Nicholson slowly becomes insane through the course of the book and the miniseries, whereas in this, he is already insane. You can tell from frame one that there is something off about this guy. And hats off to Jack Nicholson for his performance. And something else that I don't think a lot of people say is hats off to Shelley Duvall. A lot of people shit on her and say that she's a whiny character as Wendy Torrance, but she is a battered woman dealing with an unpredictable, unstable man and trying to protect her son. And I think she does a terrific job in this film, and not enough praise is given to her performance in this film. Also, the amazing Danny Lloyd playing Danny Torrance, one of the best child actors I've ever seen, just completely commands the screen and creeps you out more than any kid I've ever seen in a movie. Scatman Crothers, the late Scatman Crothers, I love him as Dick Halloran, an amazing actor, and I think he does one of his best performances I've ever seen. This film is just a masterpiece in mood and tension. You can't say enough great things about this film. I still think it's Kubrick's best film, and he did a lot of great films, but for me, The Shining will always be number one. So number 13 on my list is going to go to Trick or Treat, one of the best anthology films ever made. I do have the new Scream Factory one, but I wanted to showcase this one because this one was signed by Sam Todd, who played Rhonda. I met her at Sinister Creature Con 2 years ago. Such an awesome person. She gave me a free autograph, which was really nice. Trick or Treat is one of the staples for me around Halloween, but it's also just a masterpiece in filmmaking. I think Mike Daugherty did a terrific job. The look of this film is amazing. The look and feel, it feels like Halloween. It has just a tremendous color palette that I absolutely adore, and it brings me right into the season every time I watch it. Also, you have the amazing character known as Sam. Sam is an icon of Halloween for me. I mean, I got his lollipop tattooed on me. I absolutely love that character. Also, you have a fantastic cast. You have Dylan Baker, you have Anna Paquin, you have Brian Cox. I love how all the stories connect. I love the look and feel of the stories. They really just have this dark, twisted sense of humor, but also can be very terrifying. It's a terrific balance. Also, the music in it, Douglas Pipes, really brings you into the mood as well. Cannot say enough great things about it. I am so happy that this film, which dropped on DVD and Blu-ray 10 years ago, has found its audience. The first time I watched this film, I was shocked that this was something that Warner Brothers just threw out on video and DVD without giving it a theatrical release. And I think it's just terrific that this is such a part of the Halloween culture now. Sam is just as important as Michael Myers. I absolutely love this film. Cannot say enough great things about it. One of the best horror anthologies ever made. So number 12 on my list is going to go to Creepshow, another fantastic horror anthology, one that's been in my life since it first premiered in the movie theaters. Even before that, when I first got the comic book adaptation of this film is just a masterpiece. Creepshow has been a part of my life since I was a little kid, and it's always been one of the most important horror films of my life. It was one that scared me, made me laugh, made me cringe. It was one that brought me into the world of Tom Savini to really appreciate his special effects, the way that he put the work that he put into these special effects. I still remember seeing the crate creature for the first time, seeing Fluffy for the first time. Nathan Graham for the first time. The cockroaches with Upson Pratt. I mean, those images and seeing this on the big screen at 8 years old, I mean, was something that I will always hold near and dear. And it was amazing. What a thrill watching this. And plus you have Hal Holbrook, Adrian Barbeau, Ed Harris, E.G. Marshall, Stephen King playing Jordy Verrill, Ted Danson, Leslie Nielsen. Fantastic character actors, fantastic stars. They bring all of these characters to life and play them, sometimes over the top. They're so much fun. Each of these stories is amazing. Cannot say enough great things about Creepshow. It will still and will always be my favorite film by late great George A. Romero. And I absolutely love the music by John Harrison. I think everything in this film just plays so perfectly. One of the best horror films ever made, in my opinion. And number 11 on my list is going to go to Pet Sematary. Pet Sematary to me is probably one of the first truly disturbing horror films that I remember experiencing. A bunch of my friends took me to see this on my 15th birthday. I didn't know what it was going to deal with because I hadn't read the book, so I had no idea what the story was going to be. And I was shocked by this film. This film still to this day disturbs me. It makes me laugh in spots. It is scary. Zelda is still terrifying to me. Church the Cat still freaks me out. Gage coming back from the dead after being horribly hit by that truck. The whole setup to Gage's death in this film still disturbs me deeply. And I don't even have kids, so I can only imagine what it would be like for someone that did have kids. But wow, what a film. And I think Dale Midkiff is fantastic, Denise Crosby, the late great Fred Gwynne, who I think no one is going to be able to top that performance. He is Jug Crandall, and he does such a great job in this. Brad Greenquist does a terrific job as Victor Pascal. The young Miko Hughes is adorable and terrifying as Gage. And Mary Lambert's direction is just flawless. This film still holds up for me. I don't think it needed to be remade. I'm very disappointed that there is a remake coming out in the next 6 months. I'm very skeptical that it's even gonna be good. But again, that's just my opinion. This is a masterpiece to me. Easily one of the best horror films ever made and one of my favorite horror films of all time. That is it, my fellow fiends. Part 9 of my Countdown to Halloween series. Like I said again, thank you guys so much for being patient with me. I know that this video is very late, but because of that, you're gonna get two of these back to back. So tomorrow you can expect my last one of my Countdown to Halloween series. It'll be my top 10 of all time, my top 10 favorite horror films of all time. What a trek this has been. I'm so glad everyone has enjoyed this series. I think it's been one of the most successful ones I've done on this channel. Please let me know what you guys think of the picks I have in the comment section below. We'd love to hear from everyone. And as always, thanks so much for watching and stay tuned for part 10 of this segment coming tomorrow. I hope everyone looks forward to that and I hope everyone has a great evening. Take it easy, stay scared as always.